Thank you very much, Ilva. And perhaps just to explain, Peter's standing in for Trevor Ngwane at very short notice. Trevor's also from the South African Research Chair in Social Change. He's been arrested in Tembelihle, so unfortunately he wasn't able to join us, but Trevor's no stranger to being arrested, as I'm sure many of us know. So I want to start out with just a couple of opening remarks looking at what this particular book is about. It took me about a year to write, although it brings together a lot of the work that I've been busy on, I would say from about 2010 onwards, and particularly a lot of work that I've done for the South African Civil Society Information Service, of which I am a columnist. But the book came out last November, but what I'd like to do is to start at a different point to attempt to address the question of what the book is about. I would actually say, in fact, that the book is about the past 4 weeks, in spite of the fact that it came out last November. Now, what do I mean by that? We've seen recently a resurgence, once again, of xenophobic attacks. And this is in spite of the fact that in 2008 there was a wave of xenophobic attacks, and the State Security Agency committed itself at that stage to try and identify the trigger points, the underlying causes behind why these attacks had occurred. Yet in spite of that commitment, we've seen the attacks emerging once again. And then shortly after that, so what I think that pointed to was, amongst other things, a significant intelligence failure on the part of the State Security Agency. Then more recently, we've seen the goings on in Parliament, the mass eviction of the economic freedom fighters from Parliament before they had actually become disruptive. Of proceedings, including those members of the economic freedom fighters that weren't directly involved in the so-called disruption. We saw outrageous, entirely incoherent reasons being given for the signal jamming that took place inside the National Assembly chamber. Incoherent because one would, the reason why I say incoherent is because one would think that if the purpose was to secure a no-fly zone over Parliament, then one would do so outside the National Assembly chamber, closer to the sky where the source of the problem supposedly was, rather than doing it from within the National Assembly chamber. I think this kind of reason that was advanced by the Minister of State Security was so transparently bad that it insulted our intelligence. And I think even more recently, from Monday night onwards, we've seen the release of the spy cables, the drip release of the spy cables by Al Jazeera. And the reason why I'm touching on all these three events, these recent events, is I think that they tell us volumes about the state of health of the South African Security Service. I think, for instance, what are the spy cables telling us? Although we haven't obviously had the benefit of distance to really understand the full political significance of the spy cables. But I think what they are pointing to is a state security agency that is relatively weak and that is vulnerable to manipulation. I think that the SSA likes to think of itself of being critical about how the post 9/11 war against terror has been prosecuted by the major imperialist powers, and more specifically the United States. And in that regard, I just want to read an extract of an interview that I did with the then coordinator of intelligence, Dennis Dlomo, who since moved on from that particular role. And he was describing to me in that interview the reasons why it had become necessary to review intelligence policy as it currently stands. And he explained to me there are a lot of issues that have been overtaken over time. The lessons from 9/11 are not reflected in our policies and thinking. The white paper has not taken into account several inquiries over the world. The killing of Osama bin Laden, the Maher Arar Commission in Canada, and in the US, we've had several commissions, the 9/11 Commission, the Commission on the Weapons of Mass Destruction, and other commissions need to be taken into account. Although we were quite aware that there was a process of globalization that was unfolding, it has not been accounted for in how it impacts on intelligence. Also, the post-9/11 environment requires you to have a particular posture. The posture is not accounted for in the white paper. The bulk of the countries have come up with stringent laws that have eroded the values that flowed from the organizations that came from the formation of the United Nations. We have seen counterterrorism outside the human rights frame, and other practices are being brought to the fore, such as extrajudicial killings, detention without trial, and in the process, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the ICCPR. Aspects of these have been shredded overnight. We must all draw the lessons from this and understand that we are not pushing back the frontiers of repression, but our job is to advance the frontiers of freedom and make sure that there is security for that, but do that within the human rights frame. Americans have been shooting and killing people with drones all over the world, and we have to take a position on that. I think a very powerful, very critical statement that reflects a thinking inside the State Security Agency that is quite critical about how the war against terror is being prosecuted. However, I think that there is a gap between the ideal and the reality. I think the spy cables point to a very different reality, where the State Security Agency has developed an almost neo-colonial relationship with the imperialist powers. So we can point, for instance, to the institutional schizophrenia that becomes apparent around their approach towards Mossad. You know, on the one hand, there are fascinating descriptions of how arrogant and overbearing the Mossad operatives are. And yet, on the other hand, SSA operatives have been willing to lie in order to cover up the sale of missile plans from Donnell in order to save Mossad and Israeli nationals from embarrassment. I think there's other examples that we can extract from the spy cables that point to a kowtowing to imperialist powers. So for instance, SSA operatives have said that they didn't consider Iran to be a significant threat to global security. Yet, they wasted their time spying on Iranian nationals based in South Africa at the behest of the US. And I think that these examples, and there are others that are emerging, I think they show that the State Security Agency is talking left and walking right on global intelligence matters. Yet, I think what's apparent is that largely the cables don't really have a huge amount to say about the SSA's domestic operations. And I think there we should be particularly concerned because we know so little about what's happening with regards to its domestic work. And as I've already pointed to, alluded to, I think that the xenophobic attacks point to significant intelligence failures. I think the fact that we've had a rash of political assassinations and assassinations of whistleblowers in different parts of the country, starting in Mpumalanga and spreading to other parts of the country, notably KwaZulu-Natal, also point to significant intelligence failures as well. But yet, on the other hand, recently we've had allegations being made by NUMSA and the United Front, which it's attempting to bring into being, that its activists are being spied on, and that is likely to result in a complaint to the Inspector General of Intelligence. It has time to jam cell phone signals in the National Assembly chamber. But it doesn't have time to address these kinds of significant threats to national security. There are other signs that the security apparatus of the state is not being used in the universal interest, but increasingly in the interests of the political elite, or even more narrowly, a faction of the political elite. And what the book attempts to do is to look at how and why this is happening. So it's divided into four broad sections. The first one looks at the democratic or the authoritarian content of the security cluster, focusing specifically on the intelligence services, the police, and the military. This was an extremely difficult mapping exercise to undertake, because generally when analyses and theorizations of the democratic content of security work is undertaken, it tends to be undertaken in disciplinary silos. So policing studies people focus on the police. Security studies people tend to focus on the national security aspects. The military studies people tend to focus on their disciplinary silo. And what I attempted to do was to look at the broader trends across the security cluster. It was no small task. The second section looks at the state of the right to protest and what the state of the right to protest, particularly since Jacob Zuma came to power, tells us about the state of health of our democracy. And then the third section looks at the media coverage of the security cluster. And it asks the question, do we have the kind of media coverage that we need to truly understand what's going on inside there? The fact that this leak, this digital leak of documents recently, had to come from Al Jazeera rather than a South African news outlet is in itself a question that we need to address. Why, in fact, has this not happened locally? And there I focus particularly, I do a case study, which a number of you may already be very familiar with, of the early press reporting of the Marikana massacre. And I ask the question, why were there significant reporting failures in that early coverage that took place, and what kind of lessons can we draw about the state of health of our journalism on the growing securitization of the state? And then the fourth section deals with the securitization and militarization of information and communication technologies. It looks at the role of the SABC and the extent to which the SABC it's playing its role or not in telling this particular story. And then it moves on to look at the state of communication surveillance in South Africa. And it looks at to what extent we're seeing the kind of abuse of the communications capacities of the state that we saw being revealed by Edward Snowden last year. And it asked the question, to what extent can those kinds of abuses conceivably take place in South Africa? And through doing all of this, what I've tried to do is to develop indicators for the growing securitization of the state. And what I mean when I refer to the securitization of the state is I'm referring to turning social problems into national security threats, conceptualizing them as national security threats, and thereby inviting the intervention of the security apparatus into dealing with these problems, rather than invoking more consensual or welfare-based interventions. And in doing this, I actually had a very, very modest ambition. And that ambition came out of the debates that picked up in 2011 around the secrecy bill. I've been quite involved in the debates around the secrecy bill through the Right to Know campaign. And a number of allegations were being made by activists in R2K that we shouldn't view the secrecy bill as being an isolated affair. We should actually view it as being a symptom of a deeper systemic shift towards a more authoritarian approach to polarizing social relations in the country. And we should also see it as a symptom of a new brand of national security managers, certainly a new brand under a democracy, the Securocrats, who appeared to were becoming increasingly influential. And I wanted to assess those arguments. To what extent were they hyped up, or to what extent did they actually have relevance? And in attempting to undertake this analysis, what I discovered was that there was actually little systematic work and theorization that had been done to assist matters. The obvious empirical work that needed to be undertaken in relation to a range of matters hadn't been done, for instance. So I found that no one had really systematically investigated the extent to which the police had militarized. And in fact, there's quite a bit of work that can be drawn on globally, and probably the most prominent person who's written on these issues is a US academic called Peter Krasker, who's developed a militarization continuum which attempts to measure levels of civilianization or militarization of police services. And he developed this continuum through doing observational work in the US police in the 70s and 80s when this problem was starting to pick up. And what do we learn from drawing on Krasker's work? Well, I think what we learn and what I've attempted to bring out in the book is that the whole concept of police militarization in South Africa is understood very superficially. And I think a superficial understanding is being promoted by the police for self-serving reasons. So, for instance, we've had the police commissioner, Ria Pigaia, we've had the Minister of Police saying, and we've had the National Development Plan committing government to demilitarization of the police. But they seem to understand demilitarization as being about a set of cultural issues, about, for instance, the military ranking system. So if one strips off the military ranking system from the police, then the problem is automatically solved. But I think Krasker warns us against such a superficial understanding. So for instance, he's identified a range of organizational, institutional, and material indicators that point to militarization. So if there's, for example, military weapons transfer between the military and the police, that in itself is an indicator of militarization. If more military modes of command and control are applied to the police, that is an indicator of militarization. So for instance, in spite of the fact that the police have claimed to be demilitarizing, when you look at a deeper level, they are actually remilitarizing. So they have on order, for instance, a weapon called the long-range acoustic device, which are otherwise known as sound cannons, which are weapons that have been deployed in the invasion of Iraq, that are used in order to, they emit a sound that is so strong that they disrupt a person's balance. They can rupture your eardrums and they can cause permanent deafness. The more extreme versions of sound cannons developed by the Russians can also kill you as well, because they cause your bones to tremble inside your body. So these are the kinds of weapons that the police have on order, in spite of the fact that they claim to be demilitarizing. So I think we need to be extremely cautious by the official claims that are made that commit the police towards greater civilianization, because again, they're doing something very, very different. In relation to communications surveillance, for instance, what I found was that there was a disturbing lack of analysis about information that's hiding in plain sight. So there are a series of reports that are produced by the designated judge who has to grant or refuse interception directions in terms of the Act RICA. And these reports are tabled at the Joint Standing Committee on Intelligence, the Parliamentary Committee, and eventually those reports then find their way into the Parliamentary Chamber and as a result the public domain. But I found that no one had undertaken a systematic analysis of what those interception directions were actually telling us about how the surveillance capacity of the state was being used and abused. I couldn't find any academic or even journalistic work that focused on a basic, simple question, which is how many of these interception directions have resulted in arrests and convictions? Because that would allow us to assess the extent to which the surveillance capacities of the state are being used for fishing expeditions, or whether they're actually being used for the stated purpose of bringing down crime and protecting national security. So I guess what I'm saying about this lack of analysis, even when the information has been there, is that I think we need to take the national security beat seriously, as an academic beat and as a journalism beat, because I don't think we're doing justice to these particular issues at the moment. I think a lot of the coverage journalistically is episodic. I think it lacks depth. I think, however, that there's been some excellent work on security cluster abuses, and there we must recognize in particular the Amabungani Center for Investigative Journalism. But these abuses tend to focus on the goings-on or the conduct of the political elites. It's focused on Nkandla, for instance, where some excellent work has been done. It focuses on the shenanigans of Richard Ndluli, for instance. But I think the media have largely failed to tell the story of security cluster abuses at grassroots level. They've failed to cover that beat systematically. And these problems, had this beat been covered properly, I think we'd have started to realize that there were problems emerging with respect to how the security cluster was being abused a long time ago. In fact, these problems started emerging in the early 2000s. But I think because of this kind of analysis wasn't coming into the public domain to an extent, the elite, the middle class, have been taken by surprise about the extent of the rot that's set in. What I've also tried to do as well is, in attempting to understand what's going on, I've tried to identify common trends across the cluster that I've summarized for convenience into the five C's. And the five C's are centralization, convergence, classification, criminalization, and commodification. Now, in relation to centralization, we've had a situation since 2009 where the State Security Agency has been centralized. The various intelligence agencies that existed in the early 2000s, and in fact that grew, and their budgets grew in the early 2000s under Lindiwe Sisulu, have now been centralized into one body, the State Security Agency. And this is precisely what the White Paper of Intelligence warned against. It learned the lessons from the apartheid past, and it advocated for keeping separate the Foreign Intelligence Service and the Domestic Intelligence Service, precisely because a centralized service could be so easily abused politically. It could be captured politically and it could be abused. It warned against that. But in spite of what the White Paper said, the State Security Agency was centralized in 2009. But the necessary levels of transparency and accountability that were necessary to keep the State Security Agency straight and to prevent manipulation of this new body were not built into the system. We will remember in the mid-2000s that there was a controversy around the manufacturing of emails in order to try and portray the then contender for the presidency, Jacob Zuma, as being a victim of a conspiracy. And this, the intelligence services became caught up in this particular intra-elite battle. And out of that came the Matthews Commission, which argued for a series of reforms in order to increase accountability of the intelligence services. It's patently obvious from the recent events, including the revelations coming out of the spy cables, that the recommendations of the Matthews Commission haven't been implemented. So in other words, we've had centralization in the absence of growing accountability, and what we're seeing now being revealed is the result of that. Convergence. We're seeing an increasing convergence of the military, the intelligence, and the police. In fact, during the 2010 World Cup, there was a body that was established called NACJOINTS, the National Joint Operations Center, which jointly deploys the police, the military, and the intelligence. It conceptualizes the three as being one body. In fact, it refers to the joint security forces. But it's become very evident that this convergence is not taking place along civilianized lines. It's taking place along paramilitary and intelligence-led lines. And in fact, what has also become apparent is a little spoken about drift within police work towards what's known as intelligence-led policing. I think many people have focused on paramilitary policing and the dangers that that poses for democracy, but there's been very little discussion about a newer model, a post-9/11 model of police work known as intelligence-led policing. Which, as its name implies, puts intelligence work at the center of policing because it identifies police priorities based on the assessment and management of risk. And what this leads to potentially and has led to is profiling of individuals and the development of what the science fiction movies have called pre-crime approaches towards policing, where activists, for instance, potential troublemakers, the Trevor Ngwanes of the world, are profiled by crime intelligence as being possible troublemakers and are picked up and arrested and held in an attempt to try and prevent struggles from escalating. The problem with the shift towards intelligence-related policing is that it doesn't remove abuses, because the thinking of the police behind this is that it may preempt problems from happening in future, so it may, for instance, lead to a situation where the police don't have to shoot up the protesters, as we've seen in Marikana, because they can preempt who is going to be troublesome and who isn't. But the danger, of course, is that it doesn't remove human rights abuses. It merely drives them underground. And I think the kind of growth in the influence of crime intelligence in police work, I think, is an indicator of the shift towards intelligence-led policing and all the negative consequences for democracy that goes along with it. It, like paramilitary policing, is a more authoritarian policing form. So we're merely substituting one form of authoritarian policing for another. classification, the secrecy bill points to an attempt to overclassify information that should rightfully be in the public domain. So for instance, what should be in the public domain are the state security agency's national intelligence priorities, which guide, it's a cabinet document actually, it's adopted by cabinet, and it describes what government is going to be spending its intelligence resources on in the coming year. That document should be publicly available, and in fact it should be publicly debated in Parliament. Because if that document were available, we could start to unpack the reasons why there are systemic intelligence failures that are taking place. And in fact, what I found in the course of researching what would appear to be the national intelligence priorities of the State Security Agency, I found that there was nothing to build on because no one had actually done the work. And there is work that can be done in spite of the fact that this particular document is not publicly available. It can be done, for instance, from the annual speeches of the minister, the budget speeches of the Minister of State Security. So this is why I'm saying I think there's a lot of information that's hiding in plain sight that hasn't been optimized, in spite of the fact that we complain so much about the overclassification of information. Criminalization, the fact that it's become so easy to criminalize activists. And I go into great detail about how the Regulation of Gatherings Act has been abused by municipalities in order to effectively create criminals by forcing people who have grievances out onto the streets anyway, because it's become increasingly impossible to exercise your right to protest lawfully. People get out onto the streets anyway and then are branded as criminals by the police. And because of that, the police feel that they have got grounds to attack these so-called illegal protests, often violently. Commodification. The national security state has become big business. Communication surveillance, for instance, has become big business. South Africa is manufacturing mass surveillance technology. And through the Department of Trade and Industry, it's through our money, taxpayers' money, has been funding the development of mass surveillance technology that has been found in the listening rooms in Libya and Egypt. This will continue for as long as national security abuses remain big business. And obviously these five C's are mutually reinforcing, and I go into detail in the book about how they are mutually reinforcing. But I think I'd just like to conclude by noting, and I do make the argument in the conclusion, that I don't think we're about to descend into full-blown repression. I think that this is in spite, or perhaps because, what's happening in South Africa is starting to take on elements, some of the characters, of what could be described as a classical Gramscian organic crisis. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, I think that Zuma came to power on a pro-poor ticket. The Zuma tsunami, the Polokwane revolution, was meant to be not just simply about replacing one ANC leader with another, but it was also meant to be about bringing to the fore the poor and the working class who'd been systematically marginalized by what the SSCP had called the 1996 class project. But I think that the objective conditions in the country, given the rise of the global recession from 2008 onwards, didn't favor a radical transformation project. But also at the same time, BEE has largely failed to transfer wealth from white hands to black hands. And because of that, I think the political elites still continue to rely largely on the state for wealth generation. But the ANC is gradually losing control of the state. There is a slow but steady erosion in the electoral fortunes of the ANC. But I think if the political elite lose control of the state because of this state of affairs, they risk losing everything, which I think increases the temptation to adopt more coercive responses to the mounting social crisis that we're seeing in the country. But I think in the same way that they cannot offer substantial reforms very easily, they also cannot repress very easily. Now, why is this the case? Well, for one thing, we have a constitutional framework, a liberal democratic constitutional framework that still remains largely intact. We have divisions within the elites and within the security cluster. And in that respect, I think that the military is the Achilles heel of the security cluster. The fact that we saw the march that we did on the union buildings is an example of that. I don't think that the Securocrats within the security cluster feel that they can rely on the military. If the military were put in front of a protest and were told, shoot, what would they do? And perhaps more substantially behind that question, what is the class consciousness of the military at the moment? It's very possible that they may refuse to open their guns on the people. So there are divisions within the elites, within the security cluster. And I think the Al Jazeera leaks are probably as a result of these particular divisions. So it's important to realize, and this impacts on political strategy and tactics, the security cluster is not of one mind, and is certainly not of one repressive mind at the moment. We need to recognize that. At the same time, there's also the political costs of entering into full-blown repression. If we look, for instance, at what happened in North Africa and the Middle East, I'm sure there are the people within the leadership of the security cluster that looked at what happened to Gaddafi, for instance, that looked on YouTube at him being sodomized with a stick before he was killed. And they asked themselves, what is the possibility of that happening to us? So I think elites within the security services also make these political assessments as well, and that may well be happening. But I think one byproduct of all of this is that I think that there's also an informalization of repression as well. Given that the constitutional framework remains intact and makes it difficult for full-blown out-and-out repression to take place, I think that there's a growth in the level of informal repression, which, if these problems of political assassinations in different parts of the country aren't dealt with by the SSA and by the National Prosecuting Authority, could well lead to the formalization of hit squads. But I think that the struggle for the democratic control of the security cluster at this point in history is crucially important. I think that there's a very pressing need for more academic and journalistic work on the security cluster. And I think that this should involve asking the deeper questions. How should security be conceptualized? How should it be organized? Can the state ever be politically neutral? So in other words, is it enough to adopt a purely reformist approach towards these problems? Is it an adequate political response? I think that these are the kinds of questions, the deeper questions that need exploring. especially in view of the fact that the dominant reform model when it comes to security work has been the human security approach towards national security. And I think that human security has proved to be conceptually incoherent, and in fact in many respects quite dangerous, because in addressing the totality of factors that give rise to human insecurity, it can actually be used as a mandate excuse to draw the work of the security cluster like a skin over more and more areas of social life. It can actually mandate a massive expansion in the work of the security cluster, and I think in fact this is one of the things that's happened. And I think there are these the kinds of questions I think that need to be explored, but that the book only really poses towards the end, and they need to be dealt with, I think, in subsequent work. But I think these are the kinds of questions that I'm hoping we need to explore going forward. And hopefully the book can provide some kind of a modest starting point for doing just that. Thanks.
The University of Johannesburg. Rethink, reinvent.